There are lots of work to be done by the runtime system to manage a MapReduce computation. The master data structures include the location of files created by the completed mappers. Remember that each mapper is working on some node of the computational cluster, producing its output as files on its local disk. So the master has to have a knowledge of where those files reside, created by those mappers, and the namespace of the files that are being created by the mappers. And it also has to keep a scoreboard of the mappers and reducers that are currently assigned to work on different splits, because the number of machines that may be available may be less than the total number of machines that will be needed if I wanted to do all of the input M splits in parallel and all of the R output splits in parallel. And therefore, the scoreboard is saying at any point of time, who are all the workers carrying out mapper functions? Who are all the workers carrying out the reducer functions? When are they done? And when they are done, how should I reassign that worker to a new task? So these are the kinds of things that the master data structures facilitate the master to do. Then the big thing is fault tolerance. For a variety of reasons, the master may find that an instance of a map function that it started is not responding in a timely manner. Maybe that node is down for some reason. Maybe the link is down for some reason. Or maybe that processor is taking a little bit more time than what the master expects. It can happen very easily because in a data center environment where you have thousands of machines, there could be some machines that are slower than other machines. There could be generational differences between the machines that populate a data center. Even though they may be homogeneous in terms of the capabilities, programming environments, and even the machine architecture, they may have speeds that are different because they correspond to different generations of processes. In any event, what might happen is that a master may notice that there is no timely response from a particular instance, let's say of a mapper. In that case, it might say, well, I'm going to go ahead, assume that that mapper is dead. I'm going to restart that mapping function on a different node of the cluster. Now, when that happens, it is possible that the original mapper is actually dead, or it could be that it was just slow. In that case, you could get completion message from more than one mapper for the same split. So when you get multiple completion messages from redundant stragglers, the master has to be able to filter them out and say, ah, this is something that is a redundant work. I don't have to care about that. So that's part of fault tolerance that the master has to worry about. Locality management is another important thing. In the memory hierarchy, making sure that the working set of computations fit in the closest level of the memory hierarchy of a process is very important. And this is another thing that has to be managed very carefully so that the computation can make good forward progress in completing the MapReduce function. There is an inherent assumption in the fault tolerance model of the MapReduce framework, and that is idempotency of the mapper. That is, even though the same input data split is being worked on by multiple mappers, it doesn't affect the semantics of the computation as a whole. And that is the reason why the master can simply ignore the redundant straggler's message if, in fact, it was a slow computational engine that was working on a particular map function. And if it finishes later than when it was supposed to, and the master has already started another redundant computation to take care of that particular split, ignoring that redundant straggler message is okay because of the idempotency assumption about the mapping operation. In a similar manner, the master may assign a new node to carry out a reduce function corresponding to a particular split if there's no timely response from one of the reduce workers. And here again, the output file generation that is associated with a particular reducer split depends on the atomicity of the rename system call that is used to finally say that, oh, this is the output file generated, and the master says, okay, I'm going to commit this as the real output file of the computation. Each reducer is writing a local file, and finally, when the master gets a notification from the reducer that it has completed its work, at that point, master renames that local file as the final output file. And this is where it can get rid of redundant stranglers who come along later and say, I produce the same output file for the same split. Master will say, I've already got it, I don't need this, and it can ignore the completion message from that redundant straggler. The other thing that the programming environment has to worry about is locality management, and this is accomplished using the Google file system that provides a way by which efficiently data can be migrated from the mappers to the reducers. Task granularity is another important issue. As I mentioned, the number of nodes available in the computation cluster may be less than the sum M plus R, where M is the number of input splits and R is the number of reducer splits. And it is the responsibility of the programming framework to come up with the right task granularity so that there can be good load balance of the computational resources. And the programming framework also offers several refinements to the basic model. The way the partitioning of the input data space is done is by using a hash function that is built into the programming environment. But the user can override that partitioning function with his or her own partitioning function if they think that that will result in a better way of organizing the data. And in the map reduce framework, there is no interaction between the mappers. But if there are some ordering guarantees that are needed in terms of ordering the keys and so on, that is something that the user may have to take care of. The other thing that the user may also do is combining or partial merging to increase the granularity of the tasks that execute as mapping function. Remember that when we looked at that simple example of looking for specific names in an input corpus of data, I mentioned that the mapper can be as simple as emitting a 1 for a value every time it encounters the name Kishore, for instance, in an input file. Or it could take an input file and count all the occurrences of Kishore in that input file and finally emit the total value as the output of the mapper. That kind of combining function is something that a user may choose to incorporate in writing his mapping and reduce functions. It is very important to recognize that in order for the fault tolerance model of the programming environment to work correctly, map and reduce functions have to be idempotent. That's a fundamental assumption that the fault tolerance model of the programming framework is based on. And there are also other bells and whistles in the programming framework for getting status information and logs and so on and so forth. But the basic idea I want to leave you with is the fact that the programming framework is a very simple one. It has two operations, map and reduce. And using those two operations, you can specify a complex application that you want to code up to run on a data center using the computational resources that's available in the data center.